Good morning, everyone. Thank you. If you're here, you've managed to get through the gauntlet of our security process. So congratulations, first of all, for managed to pull that off this morning. And welcome to the NIH, those of you who haven't been here before. I'm going to, as Judith said, spend a little time talking about our precision medicine initiative. I think it has a number of applications for the type of work that many of you do in this room. And we can talk a bit more about that after I kind of walk through some of those details. So as Judith said, this is something that the president announced in his State of the Union address in January. It was probably the only time that both sides of the aisle actually stood up and clapped. That seldom happens. And then he announced it with a little bit more detail, thank you, a little bit more detail in the latter part of January. And we've been on a fast track on this effort ever since. The same day that happened, Francis Collin and Harold Varmus, who was at the National Cancer Institute at the time, wrote this piece in the New England Journal of Medicine, and I'll just point you to it if you haven't read it. It's just a nice, quick overview of sort of the vision of where we think we're going with precision medicine, and one of the first papers out related to this area. So the concept here is to build a research program that will, just as precision medicine might, you might think, is to actually get us beyond sort of trying to prescribe for the average person and instead prescribe specifically for people based on their specific, not only genetics. One of the things that I wrote in a paper a few months back was this is not genes, drugs, and disease, but much more than that. It has a lot to do with lifestyle and environmental influences and those sorts of things as well. We've worked really hard to try to be as broad about our thinking of the contributors and determinants of health as we possibly can be in this. So there's two components of this. One is a more near-term effort that I won't talk a lot about, but is specifically related to pharmacogenetics research in cancer, and the National Cancer Institute is leading that. The cancer is obviously a little bit further along in sort of pharmacogenetics and precision medicine and specific sorts of treatments for specific types of cancers and tumors with specific genetic sort of predispositions and backgrounds. So that's a whole different issue. I'm going to spend more on our longer-term effort to basically produce a gene-by-environment sort of cohort in understanding health more broadly. So here's the money that we have. If you look at it, you kind of, well, that's a decent chunk of change. That's not bad, $215 million. The Cancer Institute gets $70 million of that for the near-term efforts, Project Match, and some of the other projects that they have going on. The cohort project that I'll talk about has $130 million. That sounds like a lot of money, but we're trying to shoot for over 1 million people in this cohort. So you do the math. It's $130 per person. That's not enough to even do their genetic GWAS study. So there's a lot of work that we have to do, and we have to leverage a lot of existing resources to be able to pull this off. The FDA has some resources, and that's primarily to continue to do some of the work that they're doing in how we better regulate drugs that are more precise, that are their indications are only for specific people and specific populations, specific subgroups of people, and how do we make those determinations. And the ONC is particularly around our electronic health record system and trying to improve that. One of the things that the Precision Medicine Initiative hopes to achieve is really leveraging electronic health records in ways we've not been able to do before. So those of you who are familiar with Blue Button that the VA has used primarily in order to be able to donate or be able to see your electronic health records via some of the newer technologies, we're trying to see if we can expand that in such a way that any direct volunteer in precision medicine just basically needs to say, I want to donate my electronic records, here's where they are, and those get donated to the project as part of the effort. So that's the money that we're looking at. I will tell you as we get further on, that's the president's budget. That's also in the Senate and the House budget. It is not yet appropriated, so we got a long way to go yet. So here, like I said, is the things that we want to try to do on a whole range of health and disease issues, new approaches for detecting, measuring, analyzing a wide array of biomedical variables, and then, like I said, that includes not just genetic and cellular levels, but also at the level of behavior, physiological, and environmental. And we use environmental very broadly in this space, the social environment, the physical environment, the environment that each of you sort of deals with on a regular basis and how we assess that over time. We also, just so you understand this is we see this as a research infrastructure. So there's a lot of questions that we think we'll be able to do just by building the infrastructure itself. We also see it as a test bed. We see it as a place in which people can come in and say, you know, I need 1,000 people with these characteristics because I want to test this particular sort of thing. And then go to the cohort and ask them to be a participant in that additional study and include that in the process. So all the efforts that normally go into recruiting and enrolling and all the stuff that costs a lot of money to do most of the research that we now do can be done, I think, a lot more smoothly and quickly in the future. And that's part of our thinking as well. The other is to do this over very long periods of time, to be able to do intensive longitudinal data analysis, to not do what we've typically done in cohorts, which is ask them some questions at baseline and then never talk to them again, but instead to sort of routinely and regularly, and in some people actually quite intensively, measure their experiences and their environmental context and those sorts of things over the course of time. So like I said, over 1 million volunteers coming from two primary sources. One is from health provider organizations, the Kaisers and Geisingers and those kind of folks of the world who are somewhat skilled in both in using electronic health records and also being able to recruit patients. And the other group will be direct to volunteer efforts. One of the things the president has been very adamant about is that anybody should be able to sign up for this. You should be able to tell your brother, your cousin, your uncle, there's this project, you just go online, you sign up for it, and you become a participant in the study. You'll recognize very quickly that does not equate with being a representative study. So this is not an effort to have a representative U.S. population, but the effort is trying to be as diverse from low to high SES and across all the racial and ethnic groups and gender minority groups, all those sorts of things as we possibly can be to be as diverse as possible in that. The participants, this is one of the things that I have been really happy about over the last year, is the degree to which participants are going to be centrally involved in this process. Not only in being sort of the participants in the study, but also giving them feedback in the study, asking them for input in ways we could actually gather data better or faster or easier for them, having research questions that they might ask, even having so that the research resource that's available is not only available to researchers, but also available to citizen scientists in some limited way so that they can ask specific questions that they might have about their community or about their state, about their locality, whatever it is they might want to ask. And a new model that will engage participants and have open and responsible data sharing with the adequate privacy and security protections that are going to be an interesting process to be able to put those two together, but that's the effort. So there's a number of pieces to this, right? So there are patient partnerships that we're trying to build. Use of electronic health records being sort of a core aspect of how we sort of measure health outcomes, but not the only. A variety of technologies, and this is where the work that you folks are doing and the work that our office is doing as well, just in the use of technologies to be able to better characterize environments and behaviors and lifestyles and those sorts of things will come to bear. I've been actually very excited with the way in which PMI has embraced the use of new technologies and not tried to keep us back in the 20th century, but actually move us forward and use some of the technology we currently have available. I remind people that in 2004, when Dr. Collins wrote the first article about a vision for a gene by environment cohort, there were no smartphones. It was 3 years later before a smartphone became available in 2007, or at least the iPhone became available. So we have a lot of technology now that we didn't have even a decade ago to be able to do the sort of things that we can do there. Obviously, genomics will be a big part of this as well, and ultimately being able to try to do GWAS on everybody who is in the Precision Medicine Initiative. And obviously, the back end is going to require a great deal of data science efforts in order to be able to put this data together, especially data from all these various sources, from self-report, from sensor data, from electronic health records, from home-based monitoring data, environmental health data, data about neighborhoods and those sorts of things, all the data that we would like to be able to somehow merge and pull together in a reasonable way. So over the last 6 months or so, this group, the advisory committee to the NIH director on the Precision Medicine Initiative, have been working quite hard on putting together a report. You may not see somebody that's specifically in your area as you look at this, or you may, or somebody who at least has some interest. But this committee actually went through four workshops that we put together. The one on mobile and wireless technologies included Jonathan Kay and Mike Jarrett talking about sort of the environmental stimuli and technologies that could be used as well. So I think across the broad swath of all the things that we were trying to look at, they had good representation and were sort of well advised in the process. That advisory report came out just a couple of months ago, and if you just go, all you have to do is Google NIH Precision Medicine and you'll get to the site. But this is the site where the working group report is. We're actually following that fairly carefully, not deviating too far from it in the funding announcements that we put out. We're also coordinating actually more than I've ever coordinated before with the White House and the FDA and other agencies in this process. So they've been watching the process fairly closely. That's probably a good way to put that. And the most exciting part is, after working on this for 8 months or so, is that the funding announcements are now out. So here's the funding announcements that are out there. They just got out on the street only a couple weeks ago. There are four core pieces, and I'll talk about them later. They're the last four on this list. There's a biobank program, obviously, to be able to collect biospecimens on all these people and store them and be able to analyze them. There's a coordinating center, obviously, that will coordinate all the components of this, all the data that's coming in, be able to make that resource available to researchers. There's a program participant technology center, which is the one that I've been working on the most, and then this is the place where a lot of the home-based sensors that you guys have worked on, as well as the environmental sensors and personal sensors, Fitbits, and all those sorts of things where we reside. And then finally, one for healthcare provider organizations to be able to recruit and enroll. So those are the big four. Now, up at the top are a couple of, we realize that we need to move quickly on this. These will probably be funded sometime in the summer, but that then means that until the summer, what are we doing? So we put out a couple really fast, what we call other transactional authority efforts. And those are around two areas. One is direct volunteer pilot studies. One of the things that we were concerned about is you can't just put up a website and expect that people are going to come to it. How do you enroll them? How do you engage them? How do you keep them engaged? How do you optimize that engagement? All the things that Google knows much better than anybody at the NIH knows are the things that we want to try to learn about how to do this. So there's a kind of a pilot study that we're going to try to launch pretty quickly. Same thing on communication support, which is sort of the PR aspects of this. How do we drive people to the site? How do we answer their questions? What are the things that they consider to be important that we need to address? So those are the funding opportunities that are available. If you look at sort of structure, like I said, there's at the bottom here is the coordinating center with the data coming in from the participant technologies and direct participants and from the health provider organizations, and then the biobank that will manage and store all the data that comes from there. A couple of pilot studies, in addition to the things having to do with direct to volunteers and with communications, we're actually looking at federally qualified health centers. That's what FQHC means, to get at lower SES groups, people who we wouldn't otherwise be able to get from some of the larger health provider organizations, but we can get some of the lower SES groups by doing that and get that work done. And a fairly streamlined governance structure with an independent advisory board, an executive committee, and a steering committee, trying to move that as quickly as we can. We actually, one of the things, if anybody is interested, we're looking for the project director for the Precision Medicine Initiative. If you want a challenge, that's a challenge. But I'm not applying, by the way, but some of you might think that's a great challenge, so by all means, jump in. In terms of where you can get all the information, like I said, it's at nih.gov/precision-medicine. We've kept up to date with all the workshops, all the things that are posted on that, all the details of what's going on there. And I'll stop there and see if there are any. Do we have time for questions, Charles? Or we, one or two real quickly? Okay. All right. Judith?
This is a huge, huge effort. Are there examples anywhere else where somebody has tackled or a government or agency has tackled? I get into the ruin and,
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. There's been two places where we've both consulted with and borrowed from. One is the UK Biobank, who's done some work in this area. Now, of course, from my perspective, UK Biobank has focused a lot more on the biomedical end of the spectrum, not quite so much on the behavioral and environmental, though they have some really nice measures of some of the behavioral and environmental influences, just not quite as intensively or with the technologies we'd like to use. But the UK Biobank is growing fairly large an effort. They're probably at 400,000, 500,000 right now in terms of size and scope. And we also are trying to link with them so that some of our measures correspond to theirs so we can link data sets in the future. The other place that this is happening is in the Million Veterans Program. And again, they're at about 400,000 or 500,000 people in that. It's a much more sort of streamlined sort of cohort database, and obviously specifically veterans, so much more male than female. So those kinds of concerns that we have to address, and always just within the VA system. But again, trying to link with them as well in terms of doing that. One more question.
Yeah.
I think there's a couple places. Obviously, we're not going to roll out comprehensive, like home-based or personal environmental exposure sensors in a million people, right? But what we are thinking that we would do is do this in subgroups of people, and we'll have to think about moving forward. What would those subgroups be? What would be the people who would be most appropriate for that? There are some people that already have some of those sensor technologies available, and we can sort of just leverage what's already there. In other places, we're going to have to get those out to people and get them into a home kit that we can kind of get out to folks and do it that way. So that's one way that I think we can do that. The other is, and this is one of the things that Charlene and I were talking about yesterday, is because this is a direct-to-volunteer, any study that you have going on and what you're doing, sort of anything having to do with, you know, home or office base sort of environment and that sort of thing, if you can get the people who are volunteers in that study to also be volunteers in this study, we can then link data in ways we probably haven't thought about linking and use that and leverage that in ways that we, I think, would actually improve all the other studies that people are doing. So one of the things I've been telling people across the board is if you have a study on anything, encourage them to be part of the PMI initiative, and then you'll get genetic data and EHR data and all kinds of data that you previously haven't been able to get very easily. So another thing to think about. One more, and then I'll stop. Right. You're absolutely right. It is the Wild West in some of these things. And the validity on a lot of these personal sensors have not been, they haven't been validated, or the algorithms aren't shareable, so we don't know what we're really looking at. You know, accelerometers is the classic example of that, right? People have all kinds of accelerometers, and they won't share their algorithms, so all we can do is take raw waveform and try to figure out as best we can. You know, one of the things that we're considering doing is, again, in certain situations, diabetic patients, for instance, could we give wireless glucometers to all of them as an easy example, right? In certain situations, we could do the same thing with more research-grade actigraphy as opposed to, you know, sort of personal accelerometers for data and other types of data like that. We will ask the Participant Technology Center as one of the things that they do to look at validating existing commercial sensors that people wear and use with some regularity, Fitbits, et cetera. And can they come up with a reasonable algorithm that will get us from that commercial sensor data to something that we can rely on as being fairly rigorous and fairly valid in terms of that type of data? And if we can make that leap, then we can just leverage the data that people are already collecting on themselves. So, yeah. So I know I'm running short. I think, at least in terms of research grade, that's probably the thing that is probably the closest moving along. And has the largest penetration rate among the groups. But we're probably initially relying on smartphones and the data that's in smartphones, whether that's actigraphy or location data and personal location data, right? To be able to just even move, as many of you know, I don't need to tell this group this, to move from using a zip code to determine the environmental exposures to being able to use where the people actually are every minute of every day for a period of time is a great deal more precise than what we currently do in most of these studies. So that'll be an exciting piece of this, I think. Thank you all again. Appreciate it. Now's your chance to stand, by the way.